Is she still alive?
Thank you. And before I begin, I just want to say how I got to be here. My history is mostly social justice. When I was in South Africa, before President Mandela was elected, I had the opportunity to go to the townships and to monitor the peace with other church monitors because it was a very violent situation. And I met Ursula when I was in the townships. Ursula came, I went to Ursula, who was in a shack, a tin shack, no running water, no heat, no anything that we, but she looked like you or me. And she was a student leader. That's what reminded me of Ursula when I met you at a distance. I went up to Ursula and I said, "Ursula, how do you do this?" She was a student leader. They had protests. The school, they stopped going to school. The high school students stopped going to school because of the apartheid system. And so I said to Ursula, "How do you do this?" And she started to whisper. And I said, "So you come out every day and you gather your friends and you know, talk." And then I said, "Why are you whispering?" And she said, "I was tortured and my vocal cords were cut." And so she couldn't, she had no voice. So she said, "Now you are my voice. You go back to your country and you tell them what you saw. And you tell them how important sanctions are." Because at that time, our country did not cooperate with sanctions. And so Ursula, with nothing, she had nothing as far as this material world is concerned, is saying to me, "Now you are my voice." And I had an umbrella with me. I thought, I have to stay connected to this person. And I gave her my umbrella. I mean, you know, it's like a big help, right? And then we continued to correspond through her community-based phone. That was the only way we could communicate. She had to go to the community center at a certain time. I would call and she would talk to me from there. And so, how does that connect with tonight? Well, then I saw, maybe 10 years later, I saw a DVD about the Pacific Islanders, yes, who are losing their homes, their whole culture of thousands of years. And I looked at the faces of those Pacific Islanders, and I thought, those are my Ursula today. They were saying, "Unless you people of the North do not change your dream, we of the Pacific Islands and all the coastal regions are going to lose, are already losing our lands, our culture, unless you do something about global climate change." So that's where I come from in terms of motivation. There is no disconnect for me with social justice and environmental justice and spiritual fulfillment. And so I have gone for training, so to speak, or education to Genesis Farm, and that's now about 35 years old. But I am so happy that you are promoting and keeping the dream of Father Thomas Berry alive. Yeah. Thomas Berry, who died in 2009, maybe some of you were at his memorial service, is unique in his approach to environmental justice. So I just want to applaud you for keeping his dream alive. And what is that? It's that, in a nutshell, Earth is organic. It's a living organism. It's not a thing, and it's not something that we can treat as an object, but as a subject. And that difference, if you look at everything through the lens of Earth as living, and we as one among many species, not apart from, but together with other species, they are our brothers and sisters, that lens is going to change everything. Everything becomes a subject. We don't call Earth it, we call it her. It's Mother Earth. We treat her as a living organism. And even in things like calling land property, you have to catch yourself. What does that mean? Land is living. Native American people understand how land is not ever sold as property. But we talk about land as if it were an object or a property that we have control over. And we need to start stripping ourselves of that way of thinking. We have to begin to connect with Earth as a living organism. So, I went off script. So I do a script. I do a script because it keeps me focused. That didn't work. I'll get back. Okay. So, in the spirit of Thomas Berry, we can say we're part of a great turning. You've heard that expression. Joanna Macy uses it. It's a great shift. A great shift. We're part of the shift. We want to be part of the shift. And it's a new way of being, of interacting with all other species of life on this planet we call home. So it's a new way of being together. Now, we're fortunate to have just had Pope Francis giving an unparalleled call to us in a manner in which Thomas Berry taught. Now, Pope Francis has not quoted Thomas Berry. However, he is very close to the teachings of Thomas Berry. He is a scientist, he's a chemist. So he, in a way, gets it. And all of us need to do better in terms of our interconnection with all other species as created by God, the Great Spirit. We're one family of life. And no matter what faith tradition we come from, as we heard Kathy just speak about, we're called to be more deeply rooted in caring for our common home. Now, do you remember the story in the Christian scriptures of the fig tree? A person had a fig tree growing in the vineyard, and Jesus came looking, or the vineyard owner came looking for fruit, but found none. Then he said to the gardener, listen up, look here, for 3 years, in the United States. They had arrived there from Europe